Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you today. Hope you'll take a few moments and register your attendance. There are announcements on your bulletin of activities in the life of the church, and we encourage you to be a part of those things that are happening this week. On Wednesday morning, Wacky Wednesday will take place from 9 until 11, and encourage you to come and bring school-aged children to those activities. They've been having a good turnout and lots of fun so far this time. What time is choir rehearsal?
6:30
for choir rehearsal on Wednesday night. If you're interested in joining the choir and being part of it, we encourage you to come and be part of our singing on Wednesday night, 6:30. At 7 o'clock on Wednesday night, we have a Facebook group called Summer Bible Reading Group, and we are studying the book of Jonah. We did a first chapter of Jonah last week. We'll do the second chapter this week. Encourage you to join that group and be a part of it. The beauty of this Bible study is you can be anywhere in the world and tune in, come into the group on Wednesday evening, 7 o'clock, and be a part of that. Or if it suits you better to be Thursday at 11 a.m., you can do it then. But it'll be live on Wednesday night at 7. I encourage you to be a part of that. Next Sunday is the fourth Sunday, and we will have a covered dish luncheon following our worship service at 12 noon. Covered dish luncheon in the fellowship hall. So if you're, be sure to bring a dish to be a part of that. Are there other announcements that need to be shared? If no other announcements, then let us stand for the call to worship.
The name of the Lord is majestic.
The mountains tower and the seas roar in the praise of God.
When we look at the heavens, we rejoice in God.
The moon, stars, planets, solar systems are a light to us.
Come, let us shout our praise to God.
Please be seated. If the children would come forward for children's time with Ashley.
Okay. Good morning. What's special about today?
Father's Day.
That's right, it is Father's Day. Well, do you know what our Bible tells us? Listen, my sons, to a father's instructions. Pay attention and gain understanding. How many of you listen to your dads all the time? All the time? Wow! How many of you listen to your moms all the time? No. Why is that? Why do dads have such a power over kids? I don't understand it. Well, I believe that you listen to your father because, after all, he is older and has more knowledge than you, and he's much wiser than you are. Do you believe that? I have made a list of 10 things that wise fathers say. Do y'all want to hear it?
Yeah.
Okay. Number 10. Why? Because I said so. That's why. Did your dad say that? Okay. Number 9. Just wait till you have kids of your own. How many of y'all have heard that? That is kind of a mom thing, but dads say it too. Number 8. What did I just get finished telling you? Any of them say that to you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Number 7. Ooh, this is going to hurt me more than it hurts you.
Well, you don't want to hear that one, do you?
Okay. Number 6. Do I look like I'm made out of money? That is all the time, huh? Number 5. Not now, I'm watching the game. Or if it's in my house, not now, I'm watching deer hunting on TV. Number 4. When you break your leg, don't come running to me. I'm telling you. Number 3. No, we're not lost. Have you ever heard that one? Number 2. Be quiet. Can't you see I'm trying to think? Have you ever heard that one? And the number 1 thing on my list of top 10 things that a wise father says is, how should I know? Go ask your mother. That's right. Well, maybe your father doesn't have all the answers always, but God has blessed most of us with godly fathers, and he has commanded you to show him honor and respect. You should also remember to pray for your father and ask God to give him the wisdom he needs to train you right in the way that God wants him to train you. So I think it'd be a good thing to say a word of thanks to your dad, especially today since it's Father's Day, for providing for you and showing you love and helping you grow up in the way that you should. So let us pray right now. Dear God, we thank you for our dads. We pray that you will bless them with the wisdom needed to be good fathers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, before we go, oh wait, hold the music. I have gotten gifts for all the dads that I want you to help pass out. But last year, whenever I passed out pins for Mother's Day, there was quite a confusion. No one knew what their pins did. So I want to go over it real quick with you. This is a pin, and it writes, and there's a stylus on the end. But if you look, there's also a measuring tape, well, measuring ruler, and a level. And if you unscrew it, there's a Phillips head and a flat blade screwdriver in it. So it's multifunctional. So, and it does write. You can write with it. So, if you would like, if you could raise your hand, and the children, all the men, if you could raise your hand, the children will come and bring you a pen. No.
Thank you.
As the ushers come forward, let us prepare to present to God our gifts, our tithes, and offerings. Let us pray. Merciful God, we give you thanks this day for the gifts and blessings of life. We give you thanks for the opportunities that lie before us. And as we bring ourselves to you, to give ourselves to you in service, we ask that you would accept these gifts, tithes, and offerings as symbols of our labor, symbols of our commitment. We pray that you will use these to do your work in this community and far beyond. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please read the affirmation of faith with me. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church. We celebrate God's presence. To love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen.
We come now to the prayer concerns and celebrations in the life of the church. And certainly we celebrate the gifts that are used in our music program, and we say, praise be to God.
Praise be to God.
There are a couple of concerns I want to bring you some updates on that are on our list. Jesse Theis has had his surgery and is recovering at Texas Children's Hospital. And we continue to pray for he and his family. We say together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Also, David Cunningham has had another trip to the hospital. And after more evaluations, the family have placed him on hospice care. And we need to be in prayer for that whole family. All the kids have come in and are taking care of each other right now. But we lift them up, saying together, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Also, Pat Sanchez, her brother, Manuel Rivera, is in the hospital in Galveston, has not regained consciousness after a stroke earlier in the week. And we pray for him and his family, saying together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And finally, the brother-in-law of Jeff and John Murray is Ken Bashaw, and he is on hospice care and is nearing the end of his struggle. And we pray for that family as well, saying together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Are there others that need to be lifted up? Yes?
I have a praise. My sister, my baby sister, came all the way from Pearland to be with us today, Peggy Howell.
Katie Howell's here with us today, family visiting, and we celebrate that, saying thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Yes, sir?
Got two friends of Bunch passed away, so Matt's friend of Bunch. And also, Allison Travis, thanks to be safe travels.
And Raymond
PUNCA.
For the family of Raymond Punch, we lift up and say together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for families who are traveling to Washington, D.C., chaperones, students, and others from the school district, we lift them up as they travel to and from the nation's capital, saying together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Yes, sir? Our scout troop is going to camp this week, and Jeff Ogburn is going to be their adult, sort of in charge. And we pray for him and others and for the scouts as they go to work on specific merit badges and to have a summer camp experience. And we say together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Yes, ma'am? First for Jackson Baird, no relation, but has a young child who has pneumonia, and we lift him up saying together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And also for Mary Jo Ducrose, Mary Jo lives with a granddaughter, and she is on hospice care, and we need to be praying for them as they go through this time together. And we say together, Lord, have mercy. Yes, ma'am. Prayer of Thanksgiving for the thoughts and prayers on the death of Andy Barnett's father. And we say together, thanks be to God. Prayer of Thanksgiving for everything from summer camp. Had a wonderful time. And I had a wonderful time because y'all were there. I had a wonderful time because we had adults willing to go to camp. And spend time with their own kids and the kids of other people. And we thank God for their commitment and for their activities, and we say thanks be to God. Alex Graham's great grandmother.
Her name is, I'm sorry, Maxine Eastwick.
Maxine Eastwick.
K, like K slip.
K slip. Okay.
All right, yeah.
For Alex Graham's great great grandmother, Maxine, and she is over 100 and is being placed on hospice care as well. We lift her up, saying together, Lord, hear our prayer. Are there others? Let us turn our hearts and minds towards God as we go to God in prayer together and for one another. Merciful God, we come to you in prayer for the needs of our community. We lift up those who are sick and hurting. We lift up those who are facing challenges of various kinds. We lift up those who are caring for loved ones. And we know that you are with them. We pray that you will help us to be with them faithfully so that they may know your love at work in our lives and in theirs. We pray, O God, that you would help us to be the church in this community, to continue to reach out in ways that are meaningful, to take actions that help people when they're hungry, to help people when they're in need, to care for children, to show them God's love through activities in the life of the church, to include people in all that we do so that they will know that they have a place to belong. We pray, O God, that you would help us to be the church. This weekend, we celebrate our lives together as families. We lift up those men who have been fathers to us. We remember the ways that they have taught us, that they have comforted us, that they have strengthened us, the ways that they have held us accountable. And we give you thanks for those who have played the role of fathers and caregivers and instructors in our lives. We are also mindful that not everyone had the same experience, and we pray for relationships that may not be as strong. We pray that you would work to bring people back together as families. We pray that you would help us to understand one another more fully, and that we might continue to grow in our relationship with you as we grow in our relationships with each other. We pray, O God, that you would offer a way for us to be faithful in all that we think, say, and do, so that we might represent you in all that we can do. We pray this in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior, who teaches us to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. The sermon text this morning is from Romans 5, 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. This is the word of God for the children of God.
What do you hope for? Is there something that you hope for in your world, in your life? On what do you base that hope? If you're going to hope for something, it should be more than just wishful thinking, shouldn't it? It should be more than just maybe that'll happen kind of hope. Where does real hope come from? Well, if you're a sports fan in this area, you know what hope is. Lots of suffering and endurance. Maybe next year. Maybe the year after that. We sometimes place our faith in the wrong places. We sometimes think that things will bring us hope when they really have no ability to deliver on the promise that's offered. This week, we started the study of Jonah. The first chapter of Jonah deals with the prophet Jonah leaving and getting on a boat to go to Tarshish. And as he's going to Tarshish, the Lord hurls a great wind and storm upon the sea, and Jonah is asleep in the ship. The sailors on board the ship do everything within their power to keep the ship afloat. The sailors on board the ship draw upon their spiritual resources and they pray to their pagan gods and they do everything they can to bring about their intervention. No matter what they do to these false gods, those false gods cannot act because they have no power. They have misplaced their hope. The sailors try in vain to call upon them, but there's no one to respond. They wake up Jonah. They ask Jonah who his God is. And Jonah doesn't pray, but they pray to the God of Jonah. And then once they take him and throw him overboard at the instruction of the God of Jonah, the sea calms. They place their faith in the God who calmed the sea. The scripture says, after the sea calmed, the sailors gave thanks to God and offered sacrifice. They found someone to put their faith in who could deliver on the promise that they hoped for. In whom do you hope? And what do you hope for? You see, Paul is writing to the church at Rome and to the church at large. He's been making his case for faith in this Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified and resurrected. And he tells us that now we have a place to stand in the grace of God as provided by this Jesus who represents God's grace. We have standing in his presence by faith in the one that God has resurrected. We have a place to belong with God because of the gift that God has given us. We hope to celebrate the glory of God at work in the world. We have that promise. all by the work of God that we have faith in Jesus Christ. It's real, you see. It's not something that we think might happen. It's something that Paul can point back to and say, the cross is real. The resurrection is real. The God who made the promise to deliver has done so. And by that grace, we have this place with God. It's not something we have in the future. It's not something we have to look forward to, although we will be with God in the future. But it's something that we have in the present. It's not just something that's going to happen later, but it's something that we experience here and now, even in our suffering, Paul writes. Even in our times of distress, because we know that when we suffer, it produces endurance, and when we endure, we have that hope that things will get better. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't like suffering. In fact, I don't even like mild discomfort, to be honest. In fact, last night we got out of the movies, and we got on the highway. And I said, we're not going to eat. I'd already had a big bucket of popcorn and a giant Coke. But I was still hungry. And so my wife gave in to my suffering. And we stopped at Gringo's and had a nice meal. But I don't like suffering. But Paul says we should rejoice in our suffering because if we are faithful in our suffering, if we call upon God when we are in need, God is with us. God leads us through that suffering. He helps us to endure that suffering. And that endurance produces hope because we know that God keeps his promise as we go through that suffering together. And at the end of the day, we have more hope and more faith because we understand that God has brought us through that time of trial. You see, God helps us to understand God's power at work in our lives by bringing us through those times of trial, those times when we don't know where to put our faith. We put it in the God who keeps promises. Where do you put your hope? What do you hope for? Where is it that you find that promise? It is only in Jesus Christ. It is only in God's Son who comes into the world to represent that grace that is overflowing and inexhaustible that is able to give life to us. It is only in that promise of the one who was crucified and buried and is now resurrected. It is only by that demonstration of God's grace that we have faith that God will always keep God's promises and will bring us through our times of trial. As we go through life, we suffer. No avoiding it. Even those of us who have more or less easy lives, we have those times whenever suffering comes upon us. It may be at our own doing, and it may be at the doing of other people. One of the things about the first chapter of Jonah that we talked about, those poor sailors, they had nothing to do with the storm. It was all about Jonah and what Jonah had done that they even experienced that suffering in their lives. Jonah brought it on himself by disobeying God. Sometimes we don't know where suffering comes from. We just know that because we are human, because we are finite, because we live and we die, and those that we love live and get sick and die, we suffer. Suffering is real in our world. But our faith has an answer to that. Our faith offers hope in the midst of suffering. Real suffering. No matter where it comes from, no matter what it's doing to us, We know that we have hope in Christ Jesus, who conquers the grave on our behalf. We have been doing, for 2 years now, a grief support group. And I can tell you that in previous places where we've done grief support group, and in this place where we do grief support group, people come to discuss how the hope of their faith brings them through that time of trial, of missing a loved one, of grieving someone who's been part of their lives for all of their lives. We see hope in every discussion because we see the way that God brings us to life again and again and again. We see hope in the promise that God has that we will be with him and he will be with us and we will be his people. Where do you put your hope? Where do you put your hope? What do you hope for? God invites you to put your hope in him. God invites you to hope for life. God invites you to receive the promise that he has given in Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we sing our closing hymn, Come Christians, Join to Sing, we invite you to dedicate your life to Christ, to give yourself to God's purposes in your life, and to be used by God. We invite you to do that by making a public profession of your faith, by coming forward as we sing. We invite you to do that by joining the church and putting your membership here as we sing as well. We'll stand and sing together. Number 158, Come Christian, Join and Sing. Let us pray. Merciful God, send us into your world to be your people, to be people of hope who offer hope. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.